For my first ever video in Paleo Spotlight, I'm going to be covering an ancient end-Permian critter called Lystrosaurus. Lystrosaurus, it means shovel lizard and isn't totally inaccurate because these animals were definitely diggers, just not so much lizardy. They may seem like they were just plain little therapsids, but they were actually an extremely interesting species, and not for the reasons you might expect. In this video, I'm going to tell you all about the Lystrosaurus and why I find them to be such fascinating animals. Lystrosaurus were Dicynodontian herbivores and had two tusk-like teeth, which were actually the only teeth they had, that they used to shred up vegetation or possibly dig up nutrient-rich roots in the ground. Some species of Lystrosaurus had beak-like structures as well. Many other herbivores, both ancient and modern, must ingest stones called gastroliths to aid in their digestive process, however. Due to the Lystrosaurus's specialized teeth, they instead moved their lower jaw back and forth to grind up plant matter and didn't need gastroliths at all. Most of these creatures were small to medium-sized, about the size of a pig, cat, or a dog, depending on the species. Although, one species we know of grew quite a bit larger, with a torso that matches the length of a moose's torso at 2.5 meters, or about 8 feet long. Although they could grow to be quite large, they had these very short, stubby little legs, their back legs being quite a bit smaller than their forelegs. I guess somebody skipped leg day. More like Lystrosaurus, am I right? But really, their forearms were actually significantly meatier than their hind legs. It would make sense, since scientists believe they were diggers. They would possibly need the extra strength in their arms to aid them in digging around and looking for food, or possibly even digging burrows to live in, a lot like how moles and other living diggers have these thicker, more muscular forearms. Now, I'd like to say that I'm not a huge fan of the way most paleo artists depict these animals, because when I look at their skeletons, they appear to be quite a bit more mammal-like than they appear to be reptilian or whatever else. This is just another example of a terrible paleo art meme, where artists will just copy each other's bad, and yes, I'm calling them bad, renditions of an animal over and over again, with little to no changes in its design. I mean, just look at all these other burrowing animals. Lystrosaurus probably looked a lot more like a wombat, and less hippo or elephant-like. I believe these critters at least had some form of proto-fur, if not just full-on regular fur. If they didn't have fur and only had skin, maybe they'd look a bit more like this, with stripes or spots, or something other than just plain, drab, gray skin. I also believe they could have possessed primitive whiskers. Evidence for whiskers on early mammal-like animals goes all the way back to the beginning of the Triassic, which is right around the time that these little dudes were flourishing. But wait, Bean, didn't you say earlier in the video that these are end-Permian animals? You know, that Permian, the time in geological history right before that pesky little event called the Great Dying, where 96% of all marine life went extinct, and 70% of terrestrial vertebrates went extinct as well? Yes, and that's where I'll segue into what exactly makes these critters so special. So, the Permian ends at the extinction event and the Triassic begins. As you have likely already gathered, Lystrosaurus actually did survive the extinction event. However, they did a lot more than just survive. They basically completely took over southern Pangaea, becoming essentially what was the dominant species on Earth for millions of years. And yes, you heard me right. I said millions of years and I said dominant species. These weird little dudes were so numerous, some estimates actually put them at being 95% of the entire vertebrate population throughout their range. That would be like taking a walk outside and seeing 300 cats running up and down your street. Due to their abundance across southern Pangaea, or Gondwana, they were even used to help prove the hypothesis of plate tectonics, as their fossils were found in Africa, India, and Antarctica. So, if 70% of land vertebrates went extinct, what exactly made these inconspicuous critters so special that they not only made it to survival with the other 30%, but completely dominated? Well, there are many theories regarding this question. Lystrosaurus was considered fairly unspecialized, which means it didn't evolve any highly specialized traits that are used for getting a very specific type of food or for living in a very specific kind of environment. A common example of a specialized animal would be a koala, which are considered specialized because they mostly just eat one thing, the eucalyptus leaf. So, if the eucalyptus plant goes extinct, koalas are likely to go extinct as well. However, Lystrosaurus possibly had a varied diet and ate not only all sorts of both aquatic and terrestrial plants, but also roots and other plant matter. Okay, so that's cool and all, but it definitely doesn't explain why they were able to kick the Great Dying's butt. It's theorized that they could have been semi-aquatic animals, which may have aided them in survival. Since they could have been semi-aquatic, they may have had an easier time than animals who could only survive on land or only live in water. However, other semi-aquatic species were a lot less numerous in the fossil record at the time, whereas there were more Lystrosaurus than anything else, so that theory doesn't hold a lot of water. Another theory is that since the massive extinction event wiped out almost every single large predator, there was just nothing around to eat them and keep their populations in check. It reminds me a little bit of deer, because humans have killed off all of their natural predators like wolves and mountain lions. I already see herds of deer numbering in the hundreds along the sides of roads and in fields, so I can imagine the Lystrosaurus population would get out of hand very quickly if they had no more predators. So, that very well could have been a big reason Lystrosaurus was so numerous. The last theory paleontologists have about their survival and subsequent takeover, and my personal favorite theory, is that they actually weren't semi-aquatic at all, but were in fact burrowing animals that lived underground. Like I mentioned previously, Lystrosaurus are apparently built for digging, and their digging abilities may have been used for much more than simply getting at the roots of plants. Some scientists believe that one of the reasons the PT extinction event was so bad was because whatever happened significantly reduced the oxygen content of the atmosphere while carbon dioxide levels rose sharply. Let me paint a picture of what this might have been like. The air was near unbreathable, like if you were on the very tip top of a mountain, but the air around you was not only incredibly thin, but was also horribly polluted. There may have been years and years of acid rains falling, the skies just being choked to death with acid rain, dust, and heat. Many terrestrial species likely went extinct because they simply couldn't breathe anymore. Perhaps Lystrosaurus, with its burrowing lifestyle, was able to thrive underground where the air was stale and not quite as toxic. They also may have had some physical advantages helping them breathe better than other animals, which include things like large lungs, high neural spines that could have helped their powerful muscles better control their breathing, and short internal nostrils. However, there is some controversy regarding these physical traits as survival aids because many other dicynodonts with similar features went extinct. However, it is to be noted that Lystrosauruses from Triassic fossil deposits have longer neural spines than their Permian counterparts. It could mean that they evolved these longer spines to further aid them in breathing the new atmosphere of Triassic Earth. Or it could have something to do with their body size, posture, or many other factors that could have caused the evolution of longer neural spines. Despite all of these theories, we will probably never know exactly why Lystrosaurus survived the Great Dying and subsequently went on to become an extremely successful dominant species, making up 95% of all vertebrates at the time. All we do know is that these little guys were definitely something special, or maybe just extremely lucky. Well, I really hope you guys enjoyed my first video. I'm very new to this, so please forgive me if there are any scientific inaccuracies or other mistakes. I'm not a scientist, just a hobbyist, and all I want to do is share my passion for natural history with you. So, I hope you enjoyed learning about Lystrosauruses along with me, Bean, in the first episode of Paleo Spotlight. Catch you on the flip side.